Welcome to our ecumenical service of the Stations of the Cross. We hold this service each year on Passion Sunday, and we progress around the church, stopping at different places to read passages from the Bible and reflect on Jesus' journey to the cross. This year, due to COVID restrictions, this is online, and we have many readers from so many different places and churches. This reflective service will follow Jesus from his time in the Garden of Gethsemane through the events of Good Friday. There will be readings and reflections of the people at the time and personal reflections. Time for us to stop and remind ourselves of all that Jesus went through for us. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace to you all. Jesus told his disciples, "If any of you want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." So we pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer on a cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. We join to sing, "There is a green hill."
Jesus prays in Gethsemane. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want. He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough, the hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
It was a pitch black night. A night in which even the stars hid themselves. James, John and I had accompanied Jesus many times. Once on a mountaintop, we saw Jesus as bright as a torch, shining in glory. I could have stayed on that mountaintop forever, happy to build an altar there, but no. Jesus set his face toward Jerusalem. James is always telling me I'm so impetuous. I speak and act without thinking. Why didn't I listen to him? At Philippi, I took Jesus aside and told him not to go to Jerusalem as there were hostile forces at work. Jesus said something that was like a slap in the face. Get behind me, Satan. Satan. I deserve that because I didn't understand that the cross was the way to new life, not just for Jesus, but for all of us. But back to that Thursday night in the garden. I'm ashamed to say that we weren't much company for Jesus that night. I heard his sighs and groans as he prayed alone. He told us to keep awake, but we were tired, our eyelids were heavy, our hearts felt burdened with sorrow. At our Last Supper, I boasted that although everyone would desert Jesus, I never would. I would never fail him. But I did. I did.
And immediately as he said this, Judas, one of the 12 disciples, arrived with a mob that was armed with swords and clubs. They had been sent out by the leading priests, the teachers of religious law, and other leaders. Judas had given them a pre-arranged signal. You will know which one to arrest when I go over and give him the kiss of greeting. Then you can take him away under guard. As soon as they arrived, Judas walked up to Jesus. Teacher, he exclaimed, and gave him the kiss. Then the others grabbed Jesus and arrested him.
I know you all want to ask the question, Judas, how could you have betrayed Jesus with a kiss? But you have to understand, the dream of a Messiah and a kingdom was all but dead. How was Jesus going to unite our people against the Romans if he continued to create division, breaking the Sabbath and insulting our leaders? Jesus had become a hopeless idealist. Turn the other cheek indeed. How could any Jew dare to say, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar? No, the dream was dead. Jesus had no intention of conquering the Romans. Instead of collecting money for an army, Jesus gave the money to the poor. Oh, I saw his power, the power over demons and sickness and even death. When I turned him over to the soldiers that night in the garden, I thought I'd force him to use his power against the Romans. I was sure he'd escape like he did before in Nazareth. I didn't hate Jesus. I just became disillusioned, bitterly disillusioned. I made a tragic blunder in betraying Jesus, and I paid for it. I regret that kiss, but now it is too late.
The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death, but they did not find any. Many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. Then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, "I will destroy this temple made with human hands, and in 3 days will build another not made with hands." Yet even then, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Again the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" "I am," said Jesus, "and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." The high priest tore his clothes. "Why do we need any more witnesses?" he asked. "You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" They all condemned him as worthy of death.
Annas sent Jesus to me with clear instructions. "Caiaphas, you know what you must do. He is a dangerous man." That crafty old fox had spies watching Jesus for months. Finally, they gathered enough evidence to arrest him and to send him to me for trial. What had caught our attention was his arrogance, the arrogance to drive the money changers out of the temple, the arrogance to allow the people to shout, "Hosanna, Son of David," when he entered Jerusalem. Then the rumours that Jesus was claiming to be the Messiah. After questioning the disciple Judas, we decided to arrest Jesus secretly at night, away from the crowds. If we didn't act soon, the so-called Messiah could incite a revolution and bring the Roman army crashing down on us. No, no, better for one man to die than a nation to be destroyed. Then came the trial. The witnesses were confused and unconvincing. If there was a hope of a conviction, I had to confront him with a key question. "Are you the Messiah?" Had he said no, he could have walked away. But the simple-minded Galilean openly stated that he was the glorious Son of God. He blasphemed, and for that he signed his own death warrant. What else could I have done?
While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she looked closely at him. "You also were with the Nazarene Jesus," she said. But he denied it. I don't know or understand what you're talking about," he said, and he went out into the entryway. When the servant girl saw him, she said again to those standing around, "This fellow is one of them." Again he denied it. After a little while, those standing near said to Peter, "Surely you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." He began to call down curses on himself, and he swore to them, "I don't know this man you are talking about." Immediately, the rooster crowed the second time, and Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken to him. "Before the rooster crows twice, you will disown me 3 times. And he broke down and wept.
I was in the courtyard that night, a maid working for the high priest Caiaphas. The soldiers whisked a man in through the back door. I told the other servants that this must be Jesus of Nazareth. Then I saw a man who was a follower of Jesus. I was sure of it. He was huddled near the fire, hypnotized by the flames. I approached him. I straight away asked him, 'Are you a follower of that Nazarene Jesus?' I didn't mean to alarm him, but he became startled by my words. 'I don't know him,' he spluttered. So I walked over to my fellow workers and pointed Peter out. I said loudly so that he could hear me. Do you remember that man being part of Jesus's group? He turned sharply to us and denied it again. Finally, old Tobias, sitting round the fire, smiled at him and said, "Surely you are one of them. You're a Galilean." The man stood up cursing and swearing. He became violent, so we scattered. But I watched him from a distance. I saw a strange look in his eyes when he heard the rooster crow. It was as though death had called for his soul. Then he turned away, and I saw his shoulders rise and fall. I'd swear he was crying.
Pilate questions Jesus. Now Jesus stood before Pilate, and Pilate asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You say so." Jesus gave no answer to the charges, and Pilate was greatly amazed. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you? Jesus Barabbas, or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said, "Then what shall I do with Jesus who is called the Messiah?" All of them said, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd. He handed Jesus over to be crucified.
Jesus stands in the most human of places. He has already experienced profound solidarity with so many on this earth by being beaten and tortured. Now he is wrongfully condemned to death. His commitment to entering our lives completely begins its final steps. He has placed his life in God's hands. As I view the scene, I become moved by both outrage and gratitude. I look at Jesus, his face, the crown of thorns, the blood. I see Pilate wash his hands of the whole affair. Jesus is here for me. This is for me, that I might be free. The soldiers mock Jesus. The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace, that is the praetorium, and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Again and again they struck him on the head with a staff and spat on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him, and they led him out to be crucified.
Jesus is made to carry the cross on which he will die. It represents the weight of all our crosses. What he must have felt as he took it upon his shoulders. With each step, he enters more deeply into our human experience. He walks on the path of human misery and suffering and experiences its crushing weight. I contemplate the wood of that cross. I imagine how heavy it is. I reflect on all it means that Jesus is carrying it. I look into his eyes, it is all there. "This is for me." So I place myself with him in this journey. In its anguish, in his freedom and surrender, in the love that must fill his heart, I watch with sorrow and gratitude.
He came to a bend in the road and fell in the dirt. The cross fell on top of him, so they kicked him. He got up, shattered with weariness and loneliness. A week ago, they had called him Son of David, welcoming him as the Messiah. Now, the same people cursed him and humiliated him. The weight is unbearable, and Jesus falls under it. How could he enter our lives completely without surrendering to the crushing weight of the life of so many on this earth? He lies on the ground and knows the experience of weakness beneath unfair burdens. He is pulled up and made to continue. I stare at the weakness in his eyes. I can look at his whole body and see the exhaustion. I know forever how profoundly he understands my fatigue and my defeat. This is for me.
When the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too."
She was standing there at the corner of the path, waiting and wanting to see him. She was going to be there at his end. She would have been there with God at his beginning. She was his mother. She had fed and cradled him and watched over his growing. Whatever he had said and done, he was still her son, and she would not desert him now. Whatever pain of his she could embrace, she would. How pierced through her heart was. And in the meeting of their love, there was love, suffering, shining.
They compelled a passerby, who was coming in from the country, to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus.
For years I had dreamed of making a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. I'd saved my money to make the journey across the sea from North Africa. Whilst my family went to the market, I walked the crowded streets. I stopped to observe a pitiful procession of a criminal carrying his cross. Suddenly, before I realised what was happening, a Roman centurion seized me by the arm and forced me to carry the cross. Under my breath, I cursed the humiliation. Then I saw the face of the man I was helping. He nodded as if to thank me. I will never forget that look. Suddenly, both the cross and my heart became lighter. I had helped Jesus bear his cross. I had given him my strength. I became part of his story.
Jesus falls again. The soldiers become afraid that Jesus will not reach the top of the hill. Simon helps, but still he falls. Some of the crowd wonder, will Jesus do one of his miracles and show that he is the Son of God? Even with help, Jesus stumbles and falls to the ground. In deep exhaustion, he stares at the earth beneath him. Remember, you are dust, and to dust you will return. He has seen death before. Now he can feel the profound weakness of disability and disease and aging itself. There, on his knees, under the weight of his cross. As I look at Jesus on the ground, with all the agony taking its toll, I let my heart go out to him. I store up this image in my heart, knowing that I will never feel alone in my suffering.
A large number of people followed him, including women, who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the barren women, the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if men do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry?"
We came to mourn Jesus. We had seen his compassion and he had spoken words of healing and freedom. He had broken all kinds of religious and social conventions to connect with us. Now we were here to support him. "Don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children." I felt a chill run through my body. His words resounded like a prophecy.
Jesus is crucified. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide which each should take. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God."
Near Golgotha, Jesus fell for the last time, the last fall devastating. Jesus can hardly proceed. He collapses under the weight of the cross. His executioners look at him, broken and pathetic. They help him up so he can make it up the hill of crucifixion. I pause to contemplate Jesus on the ground, the brokenness that makes me whole. I pause to experience and receive how completely he loves me. The journey is over. Jesus stood on the top of the hill, the angry and anxious crowd looking up at him as they stripped off his clothing, exposing his bleeding and battered body. All the world seeing not his glory, but his humiliation. As the crowd stare at him, his eyes turn to heaven, stripped now of clothing, of disciples, of friends. Alone, naked, vulnerable, with nothing to protect him from what's to come. They hammered nails into the wood through his hands. They split his feet through, cutting into the cross. Helpless, he is hoisted, a shame. A mockery of a man pinned to a death gibbet. They'd won. Destroyed, rejected, broken. His very person seemed to have been shattered. As the cross is lifted up, the weight of him hangs on those nails. Every time he struggles to pull himself up to breathe, his ability to cling to life slips away. Can there be any pain or agony Jesus would not understand? This is for me. Nailed to a cross to forever proclaim liberty to all the captives.
One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And he said to him, "Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Since my cross was close to that of Jesus of Nazareth, I had a good chance to observe him, I had heard he was innocent of any crime. Some said he claimed to be the Messiah. That's why the other thief taunted him. I told him to be quiet. I was captivated by him, by his gentle manner and his forgiveness of those who mocked him. The way he talked to God, he prayed like he knew God and was close to him like a son speaking to his father. Something about Jesus made me examine my life and see it for what it was. As I looked at Jesus with his arms outstretched on the cross, I felt a deep peace and was compelled to say, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." I saw Jesus turn his head and say, "Today you will be with me in paradise."
When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home.
"They called my son a criminal. How could that be? He healed the sick, fed the poor, preached a message of love, yet they called him dangerous and they nailed him to a cross. My heart broke. I remember Jesus' birth, fleeing to Egypt, seeing him grow up and work with Joseph, losing him in Jerusalem when he said he was doing his father's business. I did not know this business would lead to Golgotha. When I saw my son dying, all that kept me going was faith, a faith in a loving, compassionate God. Before Jesus died, he made sure I was taken care of. He told John to take care of me. In a way, John was already like a second son. The thought of losing my son was overwhelming, but as I stood there with my sister, Mary Magdalene, and John, in the midst of all the desolation and pain, I felt hope."
And it was now about the sixth hour, and a darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour, the sun's light failing, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And having said this, he gave up the ghost. And when the centurion saw what was done, he glorified God, saying, "Certainly this was a righteous man." And all the multitudes that came together to this sight, when they beheld the things that were done, returned, smiting their breasts. And all his acquaintance and the women that followed with him from Galilee stood afar off, seeing these things.
I stand there at the foot of the cross, side by side with all of humanity. I experience the one who gives life pass from life to death for me. God, into your hands he placed himself, all that he was, all that he had ever been, all his beauty, obedience, loving. In God's hands he placed himself. He was returning to the Father. He was going home.
Thank you.
with Jesus. It was preparation day, that is, the day before the Sabbath. So as evening approached, Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for Jesus's body. Pilate was surprised to hear that he was already dead. Summoning the centurion, he asked him if Jesus had already died. When he learned from the centurion that it was so, he gave the body to Joseph. So Joseph bought some linen cloth, took down the body, wrapped it in the linen, and placed it in a tomb cut out of rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb.
Death is hard and final, but for us and all God's people, our hope is safe in God. From swaddling bands to grave clothes, all the days of our living and dying, we are cradled in love. They take the body of Jesus to its resting place. The huge stone over the tomb is the final sign of the permanence of death. I stand outside the tomb. This tomb represents every tomb I stand before with fear. The door is shut now, and the world sighs and waits. And we wait in night's darkness, longing for the morning, longing for the light.
Uh-huh.